So I will talk about data mining for 21st century. That is to say, it's talking about data streams. So I will present motivation, why this is important, illustrative case study, and illustrative algorithm that certifies the desirable properties that we will present. After final comments and open issues. So, we are living the fourth industrial revolution. The first appears in the 18th century, was steam engine. After electrical energy in 19th century, in 20th century is the automation, and nowadays is the IoT, the Internet of Things, that is information layer on the top of the industrial process. This is Industry 4.0. This is the revolution that we are witness. So this is Industry 4.0. We have machines that sense the environment, collect information, process that information, and send information to other machines. It's not only the huge volume of data that we are able to collect and process, but the detail that we have about what is going on around us. So this is the impact of Internet of Things in several industries. So everything that is smart cities, smart energies, connect smart agriculture, connect cars, and so forth, are based on devices that collect information, process information, and send information to other machines. And this is the growth of the digital information that we are collecting now. This is numbers of recent numbers. So, and these are the new numbers that we will talk about. So nowadays, terabytes is no more a huge volume of data. What we are talking about is petabytes, exabytes, zettabytes, and so forth. So, till during the 20th century, so the problems that is data collection, data processing, data storage, and the tools that we have were at the same scale. Nowadays, the huge expansion of data collection, our tools become obsolete. And even the model of generating and consuming data has changed. In the old model, we have few companies that generate data and send to other people. So few companies generating data and all the others consuming data. Nowadays, what we have is all of us are generating data and all of us consume data. That data. So if I want to select a restaurant, I will go to TripAdvisor or some social media and look for what people, other clients like me, the reviews that they wrote. And based on that, I make decisions. And this is for restaurants, for hotels, for blah, blah, cars, and so forth. So the most of the media that is nowadays generated is by social media. It's no more by, so the most videos is YouTube and so forth. So this is what is happening nowadays. This is a picture front público, it was published in public, and this is real-time census from mobile phones. Everybody, all of us has at least one mobile phone, and our mobile phone is always connecting to a tower. So if you count the number of mobile phones connect to a tower, we can have a distribution of the population in all countries. So, and this allows us to do real-time census. All these technologies, so nowadays we have COVID-19, Inestec is developing a tool based on the communication between mobiles. And these are the car-to-car communications, machine-to-machine, so autonomous cars, sensing the environment, smart cities and smart grids. So this is the future. And in a recent interview with Noam Chomsky, Chomsky referred that our problem is no more the lack of access to data, but understanding data. And understanding data has to do with data mining and machine learning. And this is what we will talk about. So these are the new characteristics of data. So the data that we collect nowadays have time and space coordinates, and they are produced and collected from dynamic environments. And the device that collect data has limited information processing capabilities, and they have a local view of the world, so they knows what is happening around them. If they want to build a map of the world, they need to communicate and share information. This leads to distributed environments. So our goal is to do real-time analysis, real-time data analysis, where we have decision models that evolve in correspondence with the environment. So this is what we'll talk about. And this implies that we need to switch from one-shot learning to continuously learning dynamic models. So move from static models to dynamic models that evolve over time. So in this context, finite training sets, static models, stationary distributions must completely be thought anew. And moreover, we need to take into account that our computers have computational resources are finite. So algorithms must take into account that the memory, space, time, and communications are limited resources. So this is the data stream computational model. So typically we require one pass algorithms because data is flowing, and random access to data can have high costs. Limited computational resource in terms of time, memory, and bandwidth for communication. And we need to work in an anytime protocol. So at any time, we can receive a query, and our decision model must provide an answer to that query. So some powerful ideas for this computational model are summarization. So use compact summaries to store sufficient statistics and fast update rules. Approximation, that is how much information we need to learn an hypothesis that with high probability approximate the true hypothesis with a error bound. So the third powerful idea is that we need to monitor the learning process. Learning is no more one shot, it's a process, and we need to monitor the evolution of the learning process, and this is required for things like change detection and concept drift. So this is a case study that I was involved time ago, and this is about the electrical power network, so the electrical grid. All around the electrical grid, distribution companies, they have sensors. These sensors are in fact are meters that measure the demand of energy in a specific region. So these are represented here by these red dots, and this is the medium voltage distribution network. So these sensors produce a continuous flow of data, eventually at high speed. Because these sensors come from different generations, they send information at the different time scales. And so some send every hour, about 15 minutes. Nowadays, the most recent generations send every second. And they act in adversary conditions. They are prone to noise, weather conditions, and so on. At that time, I thought that there was a huge number of sensors. It was 2,000 sensors. Nowadays, we have much more. And soon, with the installation of the smart meters in our place, we will have much more. Okay. Is now okay?
Yeah.
Okay. And the topology of network is known. We know the position of the sensor. Okay. So why we collect, the companies collect this data? So they collect for several learning tasks. One is cluster analysis, with the goal of identification of profiles. So in cluster analysis, in that case, is a cluster is a group of sensors that have, and as usual in cluster analysis, sensors that are in the same cluster are similar between them, and the sensors that are in different clusters are different or dissimilar between them. So this allows companies to identify what is the profile, urban profiles, rural profiles, industrial profiles, and so forth. I must say that the price of energy depends on these profiles. And they are interested in predictive analysis. So they, for each sensor, for each meter, they want to predict what will be the demand of energy for different time horizons. So they want to predict next hour, every hour, next 24 hours, every hour, next week. And they are quite interested in predicting peaks of demand. So this is critical. If in a certain region, the demand of energy is larger than our ability to produce energy, there is a blackdown. So the electrical grid starts falling down and propagates in cascades, so to nearby regions. And this has high costs for the distribution company. So good predictions on the demand of energy for on time, that is in advance, has strong impact in the Portuguese economy. And they use that for the tech change in behavior of sensors. If there is a change in the behavior of sensors, that this can be an indication of failures or abnormal activity. So detecting extreme values, outliers, anomalies is as impact in the Portuguese economy. So due to the economical interest of this problem, there are several works addressing all these learning types that I described. And most of them, the strategy is they select a finite sample, say they select collect data from, say, last 6 months, and they generate a static model. I have read papers about they use all different types of clustering structures using neural networks, Kalman filters, wavelets, polynomials, and so forth. And typically, these models have a very good performance for predicting in the next month. The performance starts degrading from the second month, and 6 months later, they need to retrain everything. If you take into account that we have 2,000 sensors, we have 1 plus 24 plus 96 time horizons for prediction, and different three measures of interest, so you can imagine how many models we need to retrain. And what is the problem? Well, the problem is clearly that the world is not static. If you learn a static model, the model will be outdated very soon. So this is what we'll call data streams, is high detailed and automatic rapid data feeds. Several domains generate huge data streams, internet, telecommunication, astronomy, sensor networks, and so forth. All these environments produce more data that cannot be seen by a human. And typically, we need to have near real-time analysis of these data feeds for monitoring, detecting intrusions, anomalies, classification, prediction, and outliers, extreme events, and so forth. So formally, you can data stream is a continuous flow of data generated at high speed from a dynamic and time-evolving environment. So the usual approach for querying, clustering, prediction using batch procedures cannot cope with this streaming setting. So basically, machine learning algorithms for batch using batch procedures assume that observations are IID and they are generated by some distribution that is stationary. So if the distribution that is generating examples is stationary, the usual practice of using finite training sets and static models is reasonable. But if the distribution that's generating data is not stationary, these static models fail. So if you need to maintain decision models in real time, decision models must be able to incorporate new information at the speed that data arrives, detect change, and adapt the decision models to the most recent information. And typically, this adaptation requires some sort of forgetting outdated information. So In that case, learning is a process that you need to monitor and adapt, and it's not and adapt to the most recent information. And this is not only learning, but also forgetting. In that context, we are in presence of unbounding training sets and dynamic models that evolve over time. So what we work, our framework is summarized in this slide. So now I will present an algorithm for clustering time series that is able to incorporate new information, detect change, adapt decision model for gap. So this is the clustering time series. So if you consider the electric grid and the sensors in the grid, the data that we have is we have a evolving matrix where columns are sensors and rows are timestamps. Each cell is the value of, say, of intensity or voltage of the measured by that the sensor in the column at the given timestamp. As you can see, this is an evolving matrix. Every time we have more, we add more lines to this matrix. So, and we want to group sensors. You want to obtain groups of sensors that are high correlated. So we maintain we developed an algorithm that is hierarchical clustering, and our algorithm must be able to incorporate new information, process information at the speed that is available, and need to be able to detect and react to change in the cluster structures. So I must say that we are clustering variables. So clustering the columns, the sensors. So we present an algorithm that performs hierarchical clustering. So our algorithm is based, we monitor the evolution of the diameter of the cluster. Wow. The diameter of a cluster. So a diameter of a cluster, if you consider a cluster is a group of sensors.
No, just a moment. Someone by mistake shared the screen with us and this should be stopped. I'm asking Pedro Lima to please stop sharing the screen as you are interfering with the webinar.
Tu podes parar a pesquisa, Paulo. A partilha, Paulo. Acho eu. Most.
So, but you, well.
João, I think you can go on.
Yeah. Okay. So, can you see my screen?
No, not yet.
Okay. Well, let me.
No.
And now?
Yes.
Okay. So we monitor the diameter of a cluster. So a diameter of a cluster is a group of sensors. Our similarity metric is correlation. So the diameter of cluster is defined by the two less correlated sensors in that cluster. So we have two operators. One is a splitting operator that we are growing hierarchical clustering. A splitting operator when is we expand the structure. As we have more data, as we receive data over time, we have more data, we can define a more detailed cluster structure. The second operator is a merge operator, the merge operator contracted structure. If at some point we identify that the correlation structure of the data that we are observing now is different from the data that was observed in the past, we need to react. And we react by backtracking the previous decisions. So we contract the structure. So this is what the type of structure that we learn. At the beginning, so we learn hierarchical clustering. At the beginning, we have no data. We have no information about the sensors. So what we do, we put all sensors in the same cluster. So all sensors are in the same group. After we start collecting data, and at some point, we observe that these two clusters, so these two clusters are more correlated between them than with these clusters. So we split. And now we have two clusters, this and this. Fresh data updates the statistics in this node and in this node. At some point you observe these two clusters, these two sensors are more correlated between them than with the others. So we split again. So at this moment, our clustering is constituted by these three clusters that are the leaves of this structure. When we receive a new observation, that is the value of the all sensors at a given timestamp, we update statistics in the leaves of this structure. So this is how the algorithm works. So the first thing is the similarity distance. We use the Pearson correlation, that is a common metric for clustering time series. And in fact, is a monotonic transformation of the Pearson correlation. This is just to map a correlation between minus one to one to a number between 0 and 1. So, but the important thing is how we compute the correlation between two time series. So we have two time series A and B, and the Pearson correlation is given by this expression. What is important is that to compute the correlation between two time series, we don't need to store in memory the observations. You only need to store these numbers. The sum of the A's, sum of the B's, sum squares of the A's, sum square of B, and dot product of A and B, and more, the number of points. So, at any moment, to compute the correlation between two time series, we need to store 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 numbers. Doesn't matter if you have observed 100 pairs AB or 1 million of pairs AB. We only need to store 6 numbers. So it's independent of the number of observations. This is a critical point when dealing with potentially huge number of observations. So we need to have sufficient statistics in summaries that provide information enough to compute the sufficient statistics required. So this is the first point, is that statistics that do not grow with the number of observations. So now let's how the splitting operator works. So the splitting operator works. This is a cluster. These are the sensors in that cluster. At some point, we collect data. At some point, we look for the two less correlated sensors in that cluster. And those will be the pivot for the new clusters when we expand that cluster. So after each pivot attracts the correlated sensors. Those sensors that are more correlated with this sensor goes to this cluster. Those that are more correlated with that goes to this cluster. So now the problem is how much information I need to apply the splitting operator. So the question is, how much information I need to observe to make a decision? There are few approaches to solve for this question, typically they use what we call the wrong idea. So the wrong idea is we fix the size, the number of observations a priori without looking for the data. Say, we say, you apply the splitting operator after processing 200 observations. So this is what we call the wrong idea. What is the right idea? So the information that we need is that the one that allows us to differentiate between the alternatives. So the alternatives are any pair of sensors can define the diameter of cluster and trigger the splitting operator. So if we can have differentiate the quality of these alternatives, we have that is the you have information enough to make to proceed with splitting operator. So how can we define if you have information enough? So what we do is after processing, 200 examples, we identified the two less correlated sensors. That is the farthest distance. And after we look for the second farthest distance, if the difference between the farthest distance and second farthest is larger than epsilon, means that we have information enough to make a decision. Now the problem is, how large should be this epsilon? So currently we use the epsilon is given by this expression, and this expression is known as Ofting bound. So the Ofting bound is summarized here. We have n observations of a random variable R with a range capital R. The Ofting bound states that with a probability so high as desired, the true mean of R is in this range, where this is the sample mean, and this the amplitude of this interval is given by this expression. So this expression, this is the range of the variable, this is the confidence level, and this is the number of observations. As we have more observations, this n grows, the epsilon decreases. As n grows, epsilon decreases. The interesting point of the Hosking bound is that this is valid and is independent of the distribution generating the examples. So how do we apply the splitting operator? So after processing 200 examples, we identify you check the Hosking bound. If the Hosking bound triggers, so we split the cluster, we divide the cluster. If the Hosking bound doesn't apply, we collect more information. This means that we only apply the splitting operator if the Hosking bound applies. If doesn't apply, we collect more information. So this is how the structure grows over time. As you collect more information, the structure grows. We have more detailed cluster structure. We need to discuss now the problem of change, detecting change and react to change. So, change in this context, to have an idea, is imagine that Sonai decides to build a mall in a rural area. Of course, the demand of energy in that area will change dramatically. And we need to detect those changes and react to the change. So, to understand how we detect change, we need to understand that the structure that the system that we present is a multi-window system. So, we update only the correlation matrix at the leaves of the hierarchical structure of this tree. So the leaves reside the most recent information. If you go up in the structure, we are going to the past over the stream. So the initial part of the stream fits the root node of the structure. When we expand, we update only the leaves. As we go down, we go to more recent information. Leaves store more recent information. If you go up to the structure, we go to past in the stream. So our splitting criteria guarantees that because we split by the two less correlated sensors, when we split, the diameter of a cluster must decrease. If the data is stationary. So if I have a cluster, this cluster, and after we split into these two clusters, the diameter of these two clusters cannot be larger than the diameter of this cluster if the data is stationary. So, if at any point, because this is the most recent data, this is data from the past. If at any point we observe that the diameter of one of the descendant clusters is larger than the diameter of its parent cluster, this means that the correlation structure of the most recent data is different from the correlation structure in the past. So we need to backtrack, and we backtrack by merging these two clusters, these clusters. So typically, we backtrack to the, we undo the split and start computing new statistics for this cluster. So this is how we detect change, is an increase on the diameter of the descendant clusters, and how we react. We react by backtracking. So this is the, in the electrical load problem, this is a snapshot of structure that we learn after processing 6 months of data. And this is the time series in one of these clusters. Okay, so what I present is what we call offloading algorithms. So offloading algorithms are incremental algorithms that use the offloading bound to decide how much information to collect before taking a decision. So this was presented first for classification problems by Pedro Domingues at KDD 2000, with Helena Ekonomovska, we present for regression problems, learning model trees from evolving time series, for decision rules with Petr Kocina, for regression rules with Isilda Almeida. This is the clustering with Pedro Rodrigues. For multiple models, this is with Albert Biff at work from Waikato University. And this is ensembles like bagging and boosting for data streams. And this is also, this is a work also with Albert Biffet. It's a random forest for decision for data streams. So, the offloading algorithms are important characteristics, as important, interesting bias variance profile. If you are familiar with bias variance error composition, offloading algorithms, they have low variance models, so because they only make a decision when there is statistical support, as low overfitting, because we process examples only once, there is no need for pruning, again, because we only make decisions when there is evidence in favor to that decision, and this is and we can prove that offloading algorithms becomes asymptotically close to that of a batch learner if we have computational resources enough, and the expected disagreement is given by this expression when this is the confidence level required by the offloading bound, and P is the probability that an observation falls in a loop. So, final comments. So, this is a general schema for learning algorithms. So, typically, this is a two-layer. The first layer is prediction part. This is standard prediction. We have data, some sort of memory, some learning mechanism, and we make predictions. For processing time-evolving streams. We need to have not only, this is not enough, you need to have a diagnostic part. Diagnostic part that detects change and reset the learning object, reset memory, and signals an alarm. So, if you want more details, please contact me. I will be very proud to talk with you. So, main lessons. Learning is not one shot. It's an evolving process. And we need to monitor this learning process, and this opens the possibility to reasoning about learning. So, these are using reasoning about learning means that we can have time-sensitive queries. It's not only what is the current decision structure, but which patterns disappear, which patterns appear, which patterns are growing, which patterns are shrinking. And we can learning over the evolution of the decision structure. This is another topic. Okay? Open nowadays, open issues. So now we are living this is a more general issue. We are living in a society where decision making process is men and machines. So they need to collaborate, and this requires open AI, open machine learning, green AI, take into account so the costs of computing high complex models as are very high. So, and we need to understand how machines work, how machines make decisions. And this is critical if you are in a collaboration where we need to trust the decision of machines. And this opens ethical issues and that. So it was a pleasure to talk with you about this topic. I like it very much, and I'm open to questions. So if you have time,